Good morning, students. Welcome to today's chemistry class. I hope that all of you are doing well at your homes. Okay. So in the last class, we have talked about mixture and various examples of mixture under third chapter. Okay. So today we will be starting our new topic, that is characteristics of a mixture. So before explaining this topic, I would like to remind you all that I have given all the question answers of first and second chapter, and it is available at the school website. So please, those who have not done, please go there and download it and complete all your works, because in the coming week I will be giving question answers of the third chapter also. Okay, so let's start with our topic, that is characteristics of a mixture. So basically there are four characteristics of a mixture. So let's talk about them one by one. So first characteristic says the components of a mixture may be present in it in any proportion. Okay, so if any mixture is there, then its component can be present in any proportion. For example, if you are taking sugar and water mixture, then it does not matter that how much spoon of sugar you are pouring in the water. It will be what? It will be still a mixture only. Okay. Similarly, if you are mixing iron filings and sulfur together, it does not matter that how much amount of sulfur or how much amount of iron filings you are taking. Okay. If you are mixing them together, it will be a mixture only. Okay. So it does not depends upon the amount of the components that is added. Similarly, in the cities we find that amount of carbon dioxide is more as compared to the rural areas. Okay, in cities also air is there, and air is mixture of various type of gases, and in the rural area also air is there, and air is also a mixture of various type of gases. But due to the pollution in cities, we find that amount of carbon dioxide is more, but in the rural area it is less. So the variation in the components of the air can happen, but it still will be a mixture. Similarly, in the rainy season we find that amount of water vapor is more as compared to the dry seasons. Okay, so the components of the air can vary, but still air will be what? A mixture only. We can't say that air is not a mixture, but air will be always a mixture, though its components, amount of components can vary. So like this we can say that the components of a mixture may be present in it in any proportion. Okay, it need not to be fixed. Okay, so the second point says that the components of a mixture coexist without chemically reacting with one another. Okay, so for example, if you are mixing sugar and water, okay, then when you will separate sugar and water, what you will get? Sugar and water only, no new substance will be formed. Okay, similarly, if you will mix hydrogen and oxygen together, then it will be a mixture. But what happen if you will pass electric current into the mixture of hydrogen and oxygen? It will be water. The new substance form will be water. So like this, if you will pass any external energy, then compound formation will take place. But if you are simply mixing the components together, then it will be a mixture. Okay, so you can take various examples. You can take example of sand and sugar. If you are mixing sand and sugar, it will be a mixture, because when you will separate, then you will get what? Sugar separately and sand separately. It will be what? It will be sand and sugar only. So they coexist without chemically reacting with one another. Okay, now the next point says the components of a mixture retain their properties. Retain their properties means what? If you will mix this salt into the water, then when you will drink that water, that what taste you will get? Salty taste only means what? The property of the salt is retained. The property of the salt is not changing. Similarly, if you will take the sugar is also there. If you will dissolve in the water, what will happen? It will taste sweet only. And sugar taste is what? Sweet. So the property of the sugar is also retained. Similarly, one more example I would like to give. You mix iron fillings with the sulfur, and when you will separate the iron filling from the iron sulfur mixture, what you will get? Iron only, and the other component will be sulfur only. So the properties of the components is retained. There is no change in the properties of the component after the separation of the components of mixture. Okay, so with this with sugar, one thing came to the mind. So I want to clear one thing about the sugar. So in the last class I have told you that glucose is also a sugar. Okay, so I would like to clear this point before going to the next point. Okay, so glucose is there and its formula is C6H12O6, and it is a simple sugar. Okay, it is a simple sugar which is found in our blood, in fruits and vegetables. Okay, so glucose is what? Glucose is a simple sugar which is found in our blood, vegetables and fruit. It is not found in the separate form. It is always found in the combined state. Okay, separately you will not find this glucose. It is in the combined state. Okay, and the table sugar which we use at our home, that is sucrose. That is what? That is a sucrose. Okay, sucrose is cane sugar. Okay, sucrose is cane sugar. Okay, and it is also known as table sugar. Formula is C12H22O11. Okay, so this is the formula of sucrose, which we also say cane sugar. So these both are sugar, but sucrose is the cane sugar which we can find separate form, but glucose is a simple sugar which is always found in the combined form. Okay, so both are sugar, but this is simple sugar and this is cane sugar. So this is the difference between sucrose and glucose. Okay, I think this difference is clear to you all. Okay, so let's resume to our topic, characteristics of a mixture. In that, let us talk about the fourth point, which says that the components of a mixture can be separated by physical means. So with the definition only you came to know that mixture are those substances which can be separated into two or more pure substances with the help of physical means. Okay, so those physical means can be filtration, distillation, sublimation, etc., about which you will study in the further topics. Okay, so we will discussing some other further topics. In that you will come to know about various types of separation techniques which we use for separating the components of the mixture. Okay, so mixture is what? A impure substance which can be separated into its constituent elements with the help of various physical methods. Okay, so I think that all the characteristics are clear to you all. Okay, so let's move to our next topic, that is types of mixture. Okay, so I think that characteristics is clear. Okay, so we have discussed about each and every point, and then we have discussed about various types of examples also. Okay, so there are various type of mixture which is found around us. Okay, types of mixtures. Okay, so there are various types of mixture which are found around us, and this difference in the mixture is due to the state of their components. So mixture are basically classified on the basis of its component, or you can say their components, state of its components. Okay, in what state the components of mixture are there, on the basis of that the various types of mixtures are classified. So the basic type is The basic type is solid mixture. Solid mixture. So solid mixtures are those mixtures in which two or more components of the mixture are solid. So solid mixture are those mixture in which the two or more components are solid. Next, liquid mixture. Liquid mixture. Okay. So they are those mixtures in which two or more components is what? Liquids. So solid mixture what? I have given example of iron filings and sulfur, both are in the solid state. So when they are mixed together, it will be what? Solid mixture. Okay. Liquid mixture, you can take example of oil and water together. If you mix oil in the water, it will be liquid mixture. Okay. So the next type is gaseous mixture. Gaseous mixtures, okay. So gaseous mixture, you can take example of air. In air, all the various types of gases are mixed together. So that is what? That is gaseous mixture. Similarly, solid liquid mixture. Solid liquid mixtures, okay. Solid liquid mixture, you can take example of salt and water, and then sugar and water, sand and water, chalk and water. Various type of examples you can take in which one of the component will be in the solid state and one of the component will be in the liquid state. Next, solid gaseous mixture. Solid gaseous mixture, then you can take examples of particles which are found in the air. Okay, so there are various type of particles which are also mixed with the air. Some example, soot is mixed with the gas. So soot is what? Soot is in the solid state and the gas is what? In the gaseous state. Okay, then liquid gas mixture. Liquid gas mixture. Okay. Liquid gas mixture is also there. So liquid gas mixture, you can take example of fizzy drinks in which carbon dioxide gas is there in the water. Okay. Carbon dioxide gas is there in the water. Similarly, you can take examples of river water, sea water, which have dissolved air in it. Okay. The river water and sea water are having what? Air dissolved in it. So these are the examples of liquid gas mixture, because one component of it is in the liquid state and one component is in the gaseous state. Okay, so I think that these types of the mixture is clear to you all. Okay, so now these are the various type of mixture on the basis of state of its components. So now these are various types which can be further combined and can be divided into two more categories. Now these are the various types, but these can be further, it can be combined and it can be categorized under two more types, which is heterogeneous mixture and homogeneous mixture. Okay, so there are various basically two types of mixture under which these types can be classified. Okay, so let's talk about them. And these two, heterogeneous and homogeneous mixture, in the previous class, I think that all of you have already studied about this. This is not a new topic for you all. Okay, so the first type is homogeneous mixture. Homogeneous mixture. Okay. So what is homogeneous mixture? A mixture which has same composition same composition and properties throughout is called what? Homogeneous mixture. Okay, a mixture which has same composition and properties throughout. So you can take example of sugar dissolved in the water. Okay, when sugar is dissolved in the water, then you will take first sip, second sip, third sip, whatever sip you will take, it will always taste what? Sweet. Its properties does not vary, or you can say that composition and properties do not vary. Similarly, in the case of alloy also, it is also a homogeneous mixture, which because it is having same composition and properties throughout. Okay, so there are various examples given in your book. Okay, fizzy drinks are also what? Homogeneous mixture, because in that also the composition and properties are uniform throughout. So the next type is heterogeneous mixture. Heterogeneous mixture. Okay, so the heterogeneous is what? Heterogeneous mixture, a mixture which has different composition and properties in different part of it. Okay, a mixture which has different composition and properties. Different composition and properties in different part of it. Okay, a mixture which has different composition and properties in different part of it. Okay, so for example, chalk when dissolved in the water, so do you find that the chalk is uniformly distributed in the water? No, some portion of the water will be having more amount of chalk, that is down portion, some part of it will be having different amount of chalk. So in this you can say that the composition is not same, it is varied. Similarly, when you will dissolve oil in the water, then what you will find? Oil will be at the top portion and water will be there in the down portion. So in this also, the composition is not uniformly distributed, or you can say that composition and properties are different. Similarly, sand dissolved in water, okay, all these are example of heterogeneous mixture. Okay, so the basic property of the heterogeneous mixture is that you can able to tell what are the components present in the particular mixture. Just by looking at that, you can able to tell whatever the components are added into that mixture. But in the homogeneous mixture, you will not able to make out that what component is added, because it is uniformly distributed. Okay, you can easily separate or distinguish between the different components which are present in the heterogeneous mixture. But in the case of homogeneous mixture, you will not able to make out or distinguish the components which are present in the heterogeneous mixture. So I hope that this definition is clear, and there are various examples given in your book. Okay, as various example of solid mixture, liquid mixture, gaseous mixture, solid liquid mixture, liquid gaseous mixture, etc. are given, and these examples are further classified under homogeneous and heterogeneous mixture. Okay, so I will be discussing some of the examples. Okay, so air all mixture of gases. So air is what? Air is mixture of gases, but it is what type of mixture? It is gaseous mixture, and it can be classified under homogeneous mixture. It is a gaseous mixture, but it can be classified under homogeneous mixture. Similarly, solution of salt or sugar in the water, it is also what? Solid and liquid mixture. It is solid and liquid mixture, but it will be classified under what type of mixture? Homogeneous mixture. Okay. Similarly, smoke, a mixture of soot and air. So soot and air, soot is what? Soot is solid and air is gas. So it is a solid and gaseous mixture, but it will be classified under what? Under heterogeneous mixture, because you can make out what component is present by looking at that gas which contains soot. You will able to make out that soot is present, so that will be classified under heterogeneous mixture. So similarly, various type of examples are given. This is table 3.2. So just go through a table, okay? Go through that table and learn all the examples which are given, and see that what are the examples which are under solid, liquid, liquid, solid, solid mixture, gaseous mixture, etc., and how they are classified under heterogeneous and homogeneous mixture. Okay, so I think that this topic is clear. Let's move to our new topic, that is separating the components of a mixture. Okay, now let us talk about separating the components of mixture. Okay, so by separating the component of mixture, what we get? We get the pure substance. Okay, and these pure substance are useful for us in one or the other way. Okay, so if we want to get salt from the sea water, then what we have to do? We have to do separation of the salt. Similarly, if we want to purify the water, if we want to get drinking water, then we have to do the separation of various harmful substances from the drinking water. Similarly, if the ore is there and we want to get useful metal from the ore, then also we have to subject it for the separation. Okay, so by this, what we can say, that by using various separation techniques, we can separate the components of the mixture, and these components of the mixture are useful for us in some or the other way. Okay, now just now we have studied about various types of mixture. Okay, just now we have learned that there are various type of mixture, and because of this difference, various type of separation techniques are also used for separating the components of the mixture. Because some of the mixture component will be in the solid state, some of the mixture component will be in the liquid state, some of them will be combination of the two, some of the solid is more soluble in the water. So because of this different, various type of separation techniques are also devised. Now these different separation techniques works on different principles. Okay, different principles are there on which these separation techniques work. Now these principles also, what they do, these principles make use of that property of the component in which they differ the most. Okay, suppose if we are mixing two components together to make the mixture, and if we want to separate that mixture, then we have to see the properties in which the both components are differing the most. Okay, in some of the mixture, if we are taking two components, then they can vary in their size, they can vary in their state, they can vary in their magnetic behavior, they can vary in their solubility. Okay, so in all these physical properties, they will be varying, then only we can subject them for the separation. Okay, so on the basis of these principles only, separation techniques work. Okay, so let's talk about separation techniques. Okay, various type of separation techniques are there. Let's talk about them one by one. Okay, so very first separation techniques is sieving. Okay, so we are now studying about method of separation. In that, the very first separation technique is sieving. Now this sieving separation techniques, you have already studied in your previous classes. Okay, now sieving is also known by the word shifting, and it is used for separating the solid mixture which have components of different size. Now this works on the principle of a difference in size of the particles. Sieving can only be used for solid-solid mixture. It cannot be used for other mixture. Okay, and these solid-solid mixture should have difference in their size. Then only we can subject them for the sieving purpose. Okay, now sieving is carried out with the help of a sieve. Okay, so it is a mesh-like substance which is used for carrying out sieving. Okay. This is a shallow vessel which is having small holes at its bottom. So I hope that this sieve is at your home also. So sieve is used in the kitchen also, and sieve is used at the construction sites also. So there are various fields in which this sieve is used. So in the kitchen purpose, we use what? Fine sieve for sieving the flour. Okay, in order to separate the flour from the bran. Okay. And from other particles. So the solid mixture, what, how sieving is done? A solid mixture is stirred or shaken back and forth continuously. So when we will shake or stir the solid mixture, what will happen? The larger particles, the particles which are larger than the size of the hole of the sieve will stay back, and the particles which are smaller than the size of the hole of the sieve will pass. Okay, like this sieving is done. Once more I want to repeat that the larger particles of the mixture will not pass through the small hole of the sieve. So sieve is selected according to the size of the particle which we want to sieve. Okay, so you can see in the picture that various types of sieve is also there, and the size of the hole depends on the size of the particles what we want to sieve. Okay, if we want to sieve larger particle, then larger hole sieve is used. If we want to sieve smaller particle, then smaller hole sieve is used. Okay, so different size sieves are used for different solid mixtures. Okay, so I hope that this these points are clear under sieving, and you can understand through these pictures also that how sieving is carried out. Okay, okay, let us talk about next separation technique, that is magnetic separation. So in this magnetic separation technique, we use that type of mixture in which one of its component is having magnetic property. Okay, so this is also used for solid-solid mixture, but it is necessary that one of the component of the mixture should have magnetic properties. For example, if iron being magnet is mixed with chalk, sulfur, sawdust, sand, etc., then that type of mixture can be subjected to magnetic separation. Because when you will move magnet over such mixture, then what will happen? Iron will be attracted towards the magnet. As it is shown in the figure, you can see that the nails are being attracted towards magnet. Okay, and all the other thing which are non-magnetic will be left behind. Similarly, if you will mix sulfur with iron filling, and if you will move magnet over that mixture, then what will happen? The iron fillings will be attracted towards the magnet, and sulfur will be left behind, because sulfur is what? Sulfur is non-magnetic component. Okay, so by this we can separate the mixture which is having non-magnetic component and magnetic component. Okay, by this we can separate the components by moving the magnet over the mixture. But at the high level, means at the industrial level, such type of separation will not work. With small magnet, we can't do such type of separation. So for that, we use a special type, or you can say highly modified form of magnetic separation is used. So which is known as electromagnetic separation. So electromagnetic separation also use electricity. Along with the magnetic property, it is also using electricity, and hence the term came electromagnetic separation. So by this electromagnetic separation, magnetic minerals can be separated from the non-magnetic minerals. So in the industry, various type of minerals are there. In those minerals, some of the components will be having magnetic properties also. So if we want to separate those magnetic minerals, then we have to use electromagnetic separation. Okay, let's see how this separation is carried out. So the electromagnetic for carrying out electromagnetic separation, this type of setup is there. Okay, so how it is carried out? First of all, the mixture is placed on the conveyor belt. You can see in the figure, one belt is there which is placed over the two wheels. Okay, so first of all, the mixture is placed on the conveyor belt, and this belt moves over two rollers. Okay, two rollers are there on which this belt moves, and among the two roller, one roller encloses magnet in it. Okay, one of the roller will be having magnet. So the front roller, which you can see in the figure, front roller is what? Magnetic roller, because it is having magnet in it. It encloses magnet in it. So what happens as the mixture falls from the belt? The mixture gets separated into two heaps as the grounded ore or the mixture is about to fall from the roller. It started to fall into two different heaps. Then what is the reason of this separation? So what happened as the mixture come close to the roller, magnetic roller, then magnetic roller attracts the magnetic particles and non-magnetic particles is stayed away. Okay, so the non-magnetic components is not attracted by the magnet, and it start to fall to form a heap at a distance, and the magnetic components clings to the belt and forms another heap near the magnetic roller. So as the mixture come close to the magnetic roller which has encloses the magnet, it will attract the magnetic particles and it will form one heap, and the non-magnetic particles which does not have any magnetic property, it will form another heap at the distance. So likewise, the electromagnetic separation is carried out. Okay, so I hope this electromagnetic separation is clear, and magnetic separation is also clear. Let's move to the next separation technique, that is sedimentation and decantation. Now sedimentation and decantation process is carried out for the solid liquid mixture. Okay, so this method you have already studied in your previous class also, it's not new, but let's talk about this one point by point. This method is used for separating the components of a solid liquid mixture. Okay, so it is basically used for solid liquid mixture, and in which the solid is insoluble and heavier than the liquid. So these two properties of the solid should be there for the sedimentation. First of all, the solid should be insoluble, and next, it should be heavier. The sedimentation and decantation process cannot be carried out for the soluble solid and solid which is lighter in weight. For them also, sedimentation and decantation process cannot be carried out. So what we can say, for the sedimentation and decantation, it is necessary that solid should be insoluble and it should be heavy also, so that it can settle down at the bottom of the liquid. Okay, so how this process of sedimentation is carried out? The process of separating insoluble solids suspended in the liquid by allowing them to settle down. Okay, first of all, the solid is mixed with the liquid and then it is kept for some times for the solids to settle down. So this process is known as sedimentation. When the heavy particles settle down at the bottom, then this process is known as sedimentation. And the solid particles that settle down during sedimentations are called as sediments. Okay, so the solid particles, as you can see in the diagram, the sand is settled down at the bottom of the liquid, so that sand will be what? Sediments. Similarly, if you will dissolve chalk in the water, then also you will see what? The chalk is settled down. So that is known as sediments. Similarly, mud is dissolved in the water, then also you will see that mud is settled down at the bottom of water. Then that mud will be also what? Sediments. So what we can say, the solid particles that settle down during sedimentation are called sediments. And the liquid above the sediments is called the supernatant liquid. So when you will keep the mixture for some times, you will see the sediments are settled down and the liquid above them is there, which is somewhat clear. So that clear liquid is known as supernatant liquid. And what will happen after that? After that, pouring out the clear upper liquid without disturbing the sediment is called decantation. So this process is combined. This decantation process is combined with the sedimentation. So after some times you will see what? Upper clear liquid is there, supernatant liquid is there. Then slowly we will pour that clear liquid with the help of glass rod into another vessel. So this process is known as decantation process. Okay, so pouring out the clear upper liquid without disturbing the sediments. So this process is to be carried out very carefully so that the sediments which are settled down should not get disturbed. Otherwise, the sediments will also come along the liquid while decanting the liquid. Okay, so this is the arrangement. As you can see in the figure, this is the arrangement which is made for the sedimentation and decantation process. Okay, so I hope that sedimentation and decantation process is clear to you. Next suppression technique is filtration. Now filtration technique is also used for the solid liquid mixture. And the solid which is to be used in filtration technique should be insoluble, but it does not matter about the weight of the solid. In the previous technique, that is sedimentation and decantation, I have told you that the solid particle should be heavier. But in this method, it not necessary that a particle should be heavier or lighter. Both type of particles can be used in the filtration technique. Okay, so if any sawdust is there in the water, if sawdust is mixed with the water, then this sawdust can also be separated with the help of filtration technique. Okay, so this method is used for separating a liquid from an insoluble solid, and this method is better than decantation as, first of all, it is not time consuming. As you can see in the sedimentation decantation, some time is required for the sediments to settle down, and then we have to decant the liquid very carefully. Then this will be what? Time consuming. But in the case of filtration, we need not to do any such thing. Hence, we can say that it is not time consuming. Secondly, even solids lighter than liquid can also be separated. So the weight of the solid does not matter here in the case of filtration. Okay, so filtration is carried out with the help of filter paper. Filter paper is used for the filtration process, and this filter paper is circular, and this circular filter paper is folded into cone. When this cone is folded, then it is placed into funnel. The folding of the filter paper is shown in the figure, and I think that you already know that how to fold the filter paper. So the folding of filter paper is done in the similar manner as it is shown, and then this cone shaped filter paper is placed into the funnel. This apparatus is set up as for the filtration process. The apparatus is set up as it is shown in the figure. So what you can see in the filtration process, one funnel is there. In that funnel, we are putting one filter paper which is folded in the cone shape. Then this funnel is hold it with the help of stand. One clamp stand is used, and this clamp stand hold funnel which is having filter paper. And beneath the funnel we keep one beaker which is used for collecting the liquid. And then we use one glass rod also so that accuracy in the filtration is there. Okay, so how this process is carried out? First of all, the solid liquid mixture is poured along the glass rod into the funnel. So by this using glass rod, we will be pouring liquid slowly. If we will pour directly into the funnel, then what happens? Sometimes due to high pressure, the filter paper can tear. But if we will pour it with the help of glass rod, then what will happen? Drop by drop, liquid and solid mixture will be dropped, and hence it can be filtered out properly. Then the solid particles get trapped by the filter paper. Why it get trapped by the filter paper? Because filter paper is having very small holes are there through which the particles cannot pass through. Okay, so what this filter paper do? This filter paper traps the solid particles. Okay, and the solid particles which are collected in the filter paper are called as residue. So whatever substance which are trapped, or you can say collected in the filter paper, is known as residue. And liquid pass through the holes of the filter paper. The holes of the filter paper allows liquid to pass through them. And the clear liquid which is obtained, or you can say collected in the beaker, is known as filtrate. Okay. So the solid particles which is collected in the filter paper is known as residue. And the clear liquid which is obtained in the beaker, which is kept beneath the funnel, is known as filtrate. This is how filtration process is carried out. So I hope that these four separation techniques, that is sieving, magnetic separation, sedimentation and decantation, filtration, all these separation techniques are clear to you all. And in the previous class also you have studied, so it will be more clear to you all. Okay, so in the next class we will be talking about some other separation techniques, which I think some of the techniques are new. Okay, so I will be talking about some other separation technique. Till then, whatever techniques you have learned today, read it and try to understand it. Okay, with this I would like to conclude today's class. Thank you.